And that's it. We'll have more Thames news for you tomorrow. Now, a film tribute to Sir Robert Mayer, A Debt Repaid.
South of France, Cap Ferrat, June 1982. The harpist Nicola Brooke continuing a tradition. Every year, a girl from the Francis Holland School in London plays on his birthday, June the 5th, for Sir Robert Mayer. Last year, he was 103. And that immensely long life has been dedicated to the noble cause of bringing music into the lives of young people.
It is the impact which he has made on generation after generation of people who, initiated into music by his concerts, have then come on to make music a large part of their lives.
He was the sweetest, most darling person. He was just a very, very gentle, sweet man.
There are really three Sir Roberts. There's Sir Robert, the successful pioneer in music, the patron of music. There's Sir Robert, the very successful businessman. And there's Sir Robert, the private individual very few people got to know.
He was a lovable, charming friend to have. He had an infinite capacity for loving and caring for people he knew well. And he was single-minded.
He had the energy, he had the influence, and he had the enthusiasm to provide young people with an exposure to serious music, which many of them will never forget.
The Royal Festival Hall, London 1983, and this year the Robert Mayer concerts celebrated their Diamond Jubilee. But who is Sir Robert Mayer?
Well, somebody said he was very famous, that's all I know.
I've heard of him, but I don't know anything.
Well, I just knew he was a composer.
He was the person who started off with youth music and stuff like that.
Robert Mayer was the man who, in 1923, founded these concerts to give children their first experience of listening in a concert hall to music such as Beethoven's Leonore Overture, which was played in the very first season, and fittingly, in the 60th also. His activities in bringing music into the lives of young people have borne invaluable fruit. If Robert had never been born, the musical life of this country would be immeasurably impoverished. In particular, because there would simply be far fewer music lovers. I believe that if Robert and the BBC's music department had not existed, Britain would be virtually barren of music. I think that's no exaggeration. After all, we used to be known in music-loving Germany as Das Land ohne Musik, the country without music. Now, as Robert himself is fond of pointing out, the world comes to this country to seek out music. And he's played an enormous part, an incalculably great part, in bringing that about. His awakening of a love for music in thousands upon thousands of children and young adults has made Sir Robert Mayer one of the greatest musical philanthropists Britain has ever known. He was born in Germany 104 years ago. German musical life in 1879 must have been rather like the Wars of the Reformation, split between the followers of Brahms and those of the upstart Wagner. But in Mannheim, as everywhere in Germany, music, last night's concert, tomorrow night's opera, filled people's thoughts and conversation. Sir Robert's home was no exception. Today, he lives in London.
The first sign of my musicality was when I was 5 years old. I presented my mother as a birthday present. Didn't cost anything either. With 21 melodies, which I sprinkled out with one finger. And that led to my mother then teaching me for 1 year until I was 6 years old. And then they thought my mother was too emotionally involved. And they took me to the conservatoire, and the conservatoire accepted me. And there I was taught piano. My aunts and cousins and whatnot, when I played in public, they thought the second Mozart has arisen. But my father was a very sensible man, said, nonsense, if the boy really has good talent, it'll be wonderful if it's going to be his great love, not as a profession, but as a vocation. In those days, another phenomenon, which I want to impress upon everyone who's watching me now, in those days, you accepted what your father said. There was no argument. I accepted it, and from that time onwards, I was dreamt of being this or that or the other, but I knew at the back of my mind my father didn't want it, so I never became a professional musician.
There can't be many people alive who were patted on the head by Brahms, but Robert was when he was 11.
Brahms came to my city, and the boy was going to play something for him. There was a boy who was 2 years older than I, and he was chosen, and rightly chosen, to play for poor Brahms. For me, the world ceased to exist. And the director of the conservatoire was a kindly man who saw how depressed I was. He said, well, as a compensation, I will allow you to sit next to Brahms. So during the whole concert, I sat next to him, while the other boy played to him. And gradually, the sorrow lifted a little bit, and Brahms turned around to me. He was a man with a long beard, big stomach, a lot of beer and whatnot, and sausage and what. And he turned to me and says, now, it's all right. This time, you're sitting next to me. Next time, when I come back to Mannheim, you will sit on the platform and play me. And heaven was mine.
Robert Mayer was born a Jew. In Germany, Jews had acquired civil rights in 1862. But while German unity was being forged under Kaiser Wilhelm, the ancient curse of anti-Semitism still hung over them, and the road to true equality remained closed. As it turned out, Germany's loss was Britain's gain.
First of all, my father made up his mind not to have me continue living in a country where I, as a Jew, was not a full-time citizen. I couldn't become a general, I couldn't become a full judge, I couldn't become certain vocations. Therefore, my father said, it's a very simple thing. I go to send my boys to a country where they're full liberty, and he sent me and my brothers to this country, which was a wonderful thing. For me, there's only one country, the country of my adoption.
Robert came to this country in 1896 when he was 17, and stayed with his uncle, who got him a job on the stock exchange, a world he did not find congenial. So he went into the metal business. In the evenings, he read Tolstoy, and some of Tolstoy's teaching has remained with Robert all his life, and began to move in the world of London music. Soon, his work among metals had made him successful and rich. When, in 1914, war broke out between his native land and the country of which he had become a citizen in 1902, he had no doubt that all his loyalties lay in Britain. He did vital war work in procuring metals and minerals for armaments. But nevertheless, he somehow still found time to continue with his musical life. And he even managed to get to the occasional party.
I met Sir Robert after I had joined the Royal Karl Rosa Opera Company in 1915. You know, quite a long time ago, of course. I celebrated my 90th birthday last March, and I've known him a very long time, even before he married. And I recall we were in Bradford with the Royal Karl Rosa Opera Company, and his wife, who then I think was engaged to him, came to sing the Queen of the Night when I sang the Papagena in the Magic Flute.
In 1919, when Robert was 40, he married Dorothy Moulton Piper, a musician of Irish Quaker descent.
Dorothy was a singer in her youth, and she brought in very much more than music. She she introduced Schoenberg and Bartok, who at that time were even more, you know, outre than now. She was a very point of gravity for him with regard to the promotion of music. And they were very good partners.
The Italian cantata by Handel, the only recording of her voice to survive. The Mayers had three children, Philip, who became a linguist, Adrian, a professor of anthropology, and Pauline, who in the course of her charitable work sits on many committees, a task that Robert has always avoided if he can.
My mother was a singer, and my father was an extremely good amateur pianist, and their joint interest had always been music. They met through music. And their interest, their passion in life was music. And that coupled with my father's particular interest in young people meant that they wanted to do something in the musical line for young people. This is how the children's concerts were born.
After the First World War, the Mayers went to New York. And it was there that they had the idea which was to transform their lives and the lives of generations of this country's children. They discovered a new kind of concert given by the New York Philharmonic Orchestra conducted by Walter Damrosch. The concerts were different, not only because they were given for children, but because the children had the music explained to them before it was played.
We came back to England, and then I went to business, and my wife continued her career as a singer. 2 years afterwards came a very momentous Sunday morning. And she said, all right, if they can do it in America, introduce young people to the new, to the wonderful wonderland of music, we can also do something in England. Right.
And so they did. The first concert took place on March the 29th, 1923, in the Central Hall, Westminster. Price of admission a shilling, with the unique and unprecedented stipulation, no adult admitted except in charge of children. Unfortunately, the concert coincided with a transport strike, so it wasn't an overnight triumph. Only 350 people turned up, most of them friends of the Mayors. But the second concert was fuller than the first, and the third went better still. The conductor was another friend of the Mayors, Adrian Bolt. Then the London County Council's music advisor took an interest in what the Mayors were doing. It was the first step towards their close association with the educational system. And before long, Robert had embarked on his lifelong crusade to make music part of every school curriculum. A second season was planned, but Bolt was moving to Birmingham. A successor was urgently needed. They found him at the Proms, Malcolm Sargent, then aged 28.
The plot of the opera takes place in Florida on an orange plantation. And you are to imagine, in the cool of the evening, the workers collected together to dance, a traditional dance to this entrancing music. We'll play to you La Calinda by Delius.
Then my Tolstoyan conscience pricked me. I then decided to go to the East End of London, where the poverty was indescribable. 3 or 4 people sleeping in one bed and so forth. We had 400 teachers together, and we said, we're going to bring you now music. The only point is, we want to know from you what should be charged. For something given for nothing is never appreciated. So we decided then to make a charge of 4 pence for a concert given by an orchestra full symphony orchestra conducted by then time by Martin Sartson, whose name had become known by that time. We said, all right, we'll go the whole hog. We give him part of Bach Violin Concerto in E.
Robert Mayer brought great music to such places. I preach rebellion, he said. Why should your children be deprived of a divine gift just because they are poor?
The power of music was so great, you could hear a pin drop. They gave us a tremendous courage. We said, if we can do it with them, we can also do it with others. And then it spread gradually, so within 6 years, we built up a ring of 9 different centres in Greater London. So we then started outside London, also in Yorkshire. Within a fortnight, I got terrible letters from Bradford and Huddersfield saying, you ignoramus, you started in the wrong city in Yorkshire. You should have started in Bradford, Huddersfield. I said, my abject apologies, I'll start with you too.
I went to a Robert Mayer concert when I was 9, and it was in the Huddersfield Town Hall, but I had never heard an orchestra in live before. I remember very clearly that when we were told about the music, to watch the musicians plucking the strings, I looked all over the stage for some strings. And such was my innocence about stringed instruments, I didn't realize that they meant the strings on the instruments.
This particular concert we went to was held in Leamington's Bar. It was a beautiful morning, and you can imagine a coachload of children suddenly let loose from school. Well, we arrived there, and I think the concert must have been held in the Pump Room Hall, that being the only hall large enough for such an occasion. The atmosphere inside the hall was absolutely electric, I remember, and the conductor was introduced as Mr. John Barbaroli, as he was then. I remember the way that each item was explained very carefully to us by an elderly gentleman who may have been Sir Robert Mayer himself, I really don't know, but that made it all the more interesting and exciting to us.
I was about 14 when I went to my first Robert Mayer concert in Newcastle upon Tyne, where I went to school, and we didn't have much experience of orchestral music, or hardly any at all, really. It was all brass band music and choral music in the north. And that concert was a revelation.
Now, Hector Berlioz wrote a piece called the Symphonie Fantastique, the Fantastic Symphony. And we're going to play 2 parts. The first one is called A Ball, where he dreams that a waltz is being danced. He's gone to a ball in a ballroom, and they're dancing a waltz. But because it's a dream, it's not quite clear at the beginning what's happening. You see it through a sort of misty veil, strings playing tremolos, very shimmery, very soft. And then gradually the picture clears and you can hear that it's a waltz. Very responsive audience. They're an amazingly quiet audience, actually, and there's quite a lot less coughing than you get from a lot of adult audiences in a festival hall, I say, bitterly. But also, there's the point that they are hearing the great music for the first time, and this produces a different kind of listening. It's not a critical kind of listening. It's not a listening that's about comparing the performance with the one they've got on the record at home. But this kind of listening, wide-eyed wonder, in a way, gets the best out of all of us. And the orchestras notice it.
Well, I like the bit when there's those great big crashes on the cymbals and things.
There's some children who are fairly young, and it draws it out too long for them, and they get a bit fed up with it.
I got a bit bored last time, but this time it was really good.
I thought it had a lot of life in it.
The drums kept beating and made me feel all worked up and things.
There's nothing like performing to children, because they absorb, and the better it is, the more they absorb. And you cannot cheat children. I promise you, you cannot. They know when things are not too good, and they know when something's gone wrong.
They're not blasé. It won't be the 101st time they've heard Beethoven's Fifth. For them, it's a new experience, and they respond, and they respond very quickly.
In 1929, Robert was 50 and took the inevitable step. He retired from the metal business and devoted the fortune he had made in it and the rest of his life to bringing music to children and children to music. Sometimes the children were those of very well-known parents.
It came about this way. The grandmother, Queen Mary, was always interested in new developments. So she decided to express a wish, could you come? Now, Queen Mary told her daughter-in-law, the present Queen Mother. The daughter-in-law then said, can I come along and see? But we said, well, you can come, but you must have a child. Because a rule was, this was not given for grown-ups, but for children. So she said, all right, I bring my eldest child. She brought the present queen. The present queen was then 6 years old. Now the present queen, next year or the year after, brought her sister along, and that's established the great honor which I have got of having known the royal family from the word go.
By 1938, they were giving 65 concerts a year in 25 cities. The result? 2 out of every 5 concertgoers today began to love music at the Robert Mayer concerts. In 1939, he was knighted by King George VI.
We do commission modern works every couple of years or so. And the last one, the Chamber of Horrors by Derek Bourgeois, was a very colourful piece, very entertaining piece, very well composed, and particularly designed to appeal to a visual kind of imagination in the children, although in fact it does stand on its own feet musically.
He's a very good player. He can play upwards and downwards. We have the whip.
It's an unashamedly fun piece. There are things to laugh at in the piece, yeah. And curious things, unusual instruments and so on.
Thought you'd might like that. It doesn't have to be loud all the time, these instruments like this. In the hands of an artist, it can be played pianissimo.
You must remember that in the festival hall, you've got over 3,000 children and some grown-ups. And you must be have an extrovert approach. Throw your personality out into the hall.
And the last movement of Chamber of Horrors is called Vampire Vamp. Now, you know what vamping is? It means playing the piano something like this. Thank you, Mr. Elliott. Thank you very much. He tells me he can play that tune in 3 other keys.
Well, I think the first time I ever spoke to Sir Robert was on the telephone when he rang and said, I've been speaking to Trevor Harvey, and Trevor Harvey was conducting quite a lot of the children's concerts at that time. And he said, I would like you to do a concert for the children on such and such a date. So I was taken aback a little. I said, oh, well, I don't know whether I'm free or not. Oh, you said, I've checked up on that, you're free, whether I liked it or not. And I said, well, yes, all right, I'll do the concert. And the next remark was, you know you're not getting paid for it, don't you?
He had an amazing way of getting round the hall before and after the concert, running away in those little swift strides of his, running around, talking to everybody, chatting them up, asking them what they thought of the programme, being very extremely friendly with all the children and the teachers.
He expected the best. There's no question about it. And I'm sure that if we didn't give our best, he was the type of man to come up to you and say, you know, you didn't do so well this morning as I heard you in such and such a concert. I'm sure he would do that. Thank God he didn't say that to me.
I remember his handshake. It was like a vice. I thought, how do you do, Sir Robert? And at that time, he was about 99. So I thought, well, I better not crush this 99-year-old hand. So I gave him this half-wet fish. And in return, I got a crunch of a vice. And after you've been conducting, you know, actually, it's quite difficult to take that. So I thought, well, this man is nobody's fool at all.
Chamber of Horrors, 4 demonic dancers for large orchestra by Derek Bourgeois. And the composer has just joined the conductor, Christopher Seaman, and the BBC Symphony Orchestra on the platform. The orchestra was led this morning by Maurice Brett. And there we come to the end of this concert, the 5th in the current season of Robert Mayer concerts from the Royal Festival Hall. I'll say goodbye.
The concerts stopped during the war. Robert was 60 when it broke out. But that restless spirit wanted no rest. He went to work for the Save the Children Fund in America. Back in Britain in 1943, he was asked by the Home Office to undertake an inquiry into juvenile delinquency, and then another into the practice of imprisoning neglectful mothers, of which he concluded that when they came out, they were generally worse mothers than before. The Robert Mayer concerts resumed in 1945. Nowadays, they're held only at the Royal Festival Hall, but the seeds that Robert sowed have come up elsewhere. Sally Masterman, the Yorkshire organiser of Youth and Music, is cultivating the fruits.
One of the aims and visions of Sir Robert was that he wanted to make this good music accessible to everybody. And if we're going to do that, then I think we've got to break down some barriers, and I think we've got to start young. Well, the concert today is a good example of the sort of thing that I'm trying to do throughout Yorkshire. The children that are here, I think many of them will not have been to a concert before. They've been specially invited because many of them come from less advantaged areas. And I think that as you actually see their faces, watch their faces, the concert's in progress, you'll see by their expressions how amazed they are to hear this music. It's not at all what they'd expected. Thank you.
1954, Sir Robert founded Youth and Music, which went on from where the concerts for children left off. This was for young people up to the age of 30. Once again, he poured his own money into it, £200,000 in the first 10 years. In 1976, he became honorary president of the International Youth Orchestra, a post he still holds.
Well, Sir Robert established Youth and Music with the aim of encouraging young people to go to concerts. And we do this primarily by organizing a discount ticket scheme, which offers people under 30 the opportunity to buy tickets at greatly reduced prices for a large variety of events, from concerts, opera, dance, through to jazz. In Yorkshire, we continue this idea of supporting the scheme with informal concerts, but we also do a bit more than that. We promote, for example, family concerts. There's the Sunday coffee concerts, actually, here in Cartwright Hall. These have proved very successful. And also we promote children's concerts. I think that you've got to somehow introduce them to concert going in a way that they're really going to enjoy. You've got to stimulate them. And we find that by putting on concerts for this sort of age group and using groups and musicians who can establish a very special rapport with the young audience, it's really a musical entertainment. One of the advantages of doing it in spare time is that you have got a captive audience. And this means that you can reach children who wouldn't normally want to go to concerts or think of going to concerts, that if it was out of school time, they wouldn't go and they don't want to know.
Now, as I say, it's just a coiled tube.
And I would imagine that a lot of the children coming today will either stay, will say, well, concerts are stuffy, I'm not interested, or say, well, I don't really know, and it'll be interesting to find out. And hopefully they will be stimulated by this, and we can work on that enthusiasm.
Robert has always been an enthusiastic traveller and an equally enthusiastic amateur cameraman. He visited India in 1948, where he met Pandit Nehru, the Prime Minister. In 1951, he went to Israel. Among those he met was David Ben-Gurion. And wherever he went, he always found time to mingle with the children, as well as meeting the leaders.
He loved children, and he loved being with children, and of course he was a very tactile man, so he loved wherever he was holding a child's hand and drawing any children to him if we were shopping or something. We went away with our parents a lot, which in those days I think was quite an unusual thing to do. We went on holidays always with our parents. But he had no hobbies, and he, as he was quite old during my childhood, he tried to play tennis a little bit with us, and he rode with us and so on. But he certainly wasn't a young father.
In 1969, Robert was 90. His birthday concert was attended by the Queen. In 1972, together with Lord Droyder, Robert founded the Droyder Mayor Scholarship of £5,000 to help promising young singers continue their studies. One of the first winners was a particularly promising soprano, who is now Dame Kirita Kanua.
To Sir Robert Mayer's house with Lord Droyder. And here I was sitting, this young student, with these two old men. And if you think about it now, 14 years later, they weren't so old. You know, they were really two wonderful men giving their time, energy, and their money to make me go and study in Italy, where I did actually take it up. I must say, if I didn't have it, I wouldn't have gotten anywhere. The scholarship was of vital importance. I started off with a scholarship coming from Australia, being born in New Zealand. And so that scholarship helped me a lot. But this Joyda Mayer one was most important because it was at a time where I should have been studying and not going into performances and not having to work in order to survive. Then, of course, we met again and again, and I've had many, many letters from him. In his letters, he would talk as a fan would talk, which was rather sweet from a gentleman of that standing. And he would say how much he'd enjoyed my performance and how he'd enjoyed the whole evening, and my voice was really maturing, growing. But he would never, ever comment on what he'd actually done for me, which was rather sweet.
In 1973, Robert Mayer became a Companion of Honour on the recommendation of Mr. Heath, then Prime Minister.
I decided to recommend to the Queen that she should confer on Sir Robert the Companion of Honour because I felt that his services had been of such a high nature both to music and to his own country. They had been sustained over a very long period. Sometimes there are people who are critical of honours being conferred on those they would describe as being of advanced age. I've never shared that view, and I felt that he had done so much over more than 50 years for music as a whole, musicians, for young children with his own concerts, made such an impact on the musical life of this country that it was fully justified. When it became the Golden Jubilee of the Robert Mayer Children's Concerts, which were, of course, really his main interest, he decided the time had come to ensure their permanent survival. He negotiated with the BBC to take them over. The handover concert, which was the Golden Jubilee concert as well, at the BBC, and Sir Robert asked me if I would conduct. I was delighted because it was a Christmas concert. I remember also it was rather difficult because just before the concert, his wife was very ill, and it was thought that she wouldn't last to be at the concert. And so I had to think about this, and we agreed that the orchestra would play Nimrod from Elgar's Enigma Variations, and everything was arranged. She then made a sudden and very remarkable recovery and appeared at the concert. So I had to take out Elgar's Nimrod. And I put in Handel's Queen of Sheba, the arrival of the Queen of Sheba from Solomon. So that made it a much more cheerful program.
In 1974, Dorothy Mayer died. They had been married for 55 years.
After my mother died, my father naturally took a little bit of time to adjust himself and pick up, and then quite characteristically, he looked to the future and said to himself, why am I still here? He was 7 years older than my mother.
He regarded himself as a medical freak. At the age of 80, he had a massive heart attack. At the age of 99, he had a massive stroke. And yet he survived both of them without an impediment. He only lost this will to live once, and that is when Lady Dorothy Mayer died. He very much wanted to join her. He thought his life had come to an end. There was nothing to look forward to.
My wife was much more rigid, and I learned really through her death, more or less, that what I'd done was man-made. Man-made is not sufficient. It must be God-made. So I become a religious person who believes no accidents, anything like this. I'm now here by, I don't know why I'm here, at my age, apparently fairly compassmentous. But why? This is a must have a meaning.
He came to a very characteristic conclusion that he hadn't finished his work, and there was still a lot that he could still do.
I start from the assumption that we were not meant to know. If we were meant to know, we would also know what happened after our death. We're not meant to know. Those are the great mysteries which no human being can hope to solve. You accept it. Then you're bargaining. I don't bargain.
In 1979, Robert's 100th birthday was marked by a moving and memorable concert in the Royal Festival Hall. During the interval, the Queen made him a Knight Companion of the Royal Victorian Order, to the delight of his 3,000 friends who packed the hall.
Your Majesty, an hour ago, I was overwhelmed for the great honor you did me. And I want to thank you again with all my heart. May I also be permitted to thank you, ma'am, for honoring once more with your august presence. You first came to my wives and my concerts when you had reached the great age of 6 years. And you have kept up this tradition throughout your glorious reign. May I paraphrase an old saying, like mother, like son. His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales, first came to our concerts at an even earlier age than you, ma'am. He came when he was of an exact 4 years and 1 day old. It seems therefore natural that we at Youth and Music can claim your Royal Highness as our president.
It was a happy evening, but no one chortled more or gurgled more, absolutely with the utmost abandon than he. It was marvelous.
I think it was a grand and glorious night. I have always admired, respected age. I think there comes a time when the mere fact of surviving, and surviving so happily and well and contributing continually to society, deserves a tribute.
Well, it was nearly a whole year, the celebration. It was a tremendous year for him. And he was feted not only in this country, but in other countries as well. It was tremendously exciting to be with him, and he so much enjoyed the whole performance of that 100th year. The concert itself, of course, was a little frightening, because having booked the soloists and having got the acceptance from the royal family that they were going to attend, we had to go ahead with the concert. Whether it was a memorial concert or a birthday concert.
All his ambitions really were fulfilled, bar the last one. The last ambition never got fulfilled, because he planned at the age of 101 to have a concert, a peace concert for the Middle East. He wanted Leonard Bernstein to conduct. He wanted Pope John Paul II to be patron of this concert, a kind of peace concert for youth to celebrate peace in the Middle East. And this, unfortunately, never was fulfilled. He never really had the time in the end and the opportunity of doing so. Besides, he got married again. The new Lady Mayor has taken good care of him, and so he is still alive today, because he might have exerted himself too much.
Robert married again in November 1980. His second wife is the former Mrs. Jacqueline Noble. They have just celebrated his 104th birthday.
So let's begin our improvisation, which will start quiet, get louder, and then get softer again. And we're going to begin with Wayne here. So could we start?
Sir Robert was a visionary who loved music and whose life was enriched by it, and wanted as many other people as possible to experience the same thing. And he also had the sense to realize that you can only reach people in that kind of area when they're young.
Numbers of people who are now my age who love music very much probably owe a great deal to him. And if he hadn't done what he had done, they would not have the pleasure that they do now.
I'm certain that much of his motive came from the desire to express gratitude to the English, to his being afforded such a warm welcome, such opportunities. On the other hand, he wasn't doing any more than so many voluntary bodies, so many leaders and members of voluntary bodies do already in England. This is the country of people who set out to help others, to help people all over the world. It is a country that has known social responsibility.
He was convinced that life was not easy, that one should, as Arthur Schnabel once said, take the line of most resistance. And that the harder one struggled, the more one would achieve, and so on. This was very much, again, his idea of always looking to the future, never looking back.
Robert was always a firm believer that the best committee was one of three, two of whom were always absent. And he always made sure he was the one there. And I think, in a way, if you want something done, you do it yourself. And he did. And unlike many other people, he was willing to put his own hand in his pocket and not ask other people first.
I suppose, looking at him as a darling, darling man, much loved by people all over the world, mostly by British people, I think that his contribution to the young society for the last at least 60 years has been a massive contribution. And who else is going to take his place? That, tell me that. Most important of all. Where is the next Sir Robert Mayor?
I've always thought of Robert as simply immortal. But there is an ancient saying, treat every day as though it was your last. A few days before his 100th birthday, I was with him in his flat. We talked for about an hour. And I had a marvelous hour, I may say, because he's a very funny man, very witty and extremely outspoken. And I've always loved his conversation, always have done. But when it was time for me to go, I got up. And he said, oh, forgive me not getting up to show you out. He was in a wheelchair by then, and I said, well, of course not. Of course you mustn't. Don't be ridiculous. Thinking that this was the courtesy of the host, and he has always been a very courteous man, Robert. But it wasn't that, not a bit. It was something else. He said, these were his exact words. I wrote them down as soon as I got outside. He said, you see, when you're my age, you mustn't waste a second. And I realized that he'd lived by that maxim all his life. In fact, Sir Robert Mayer could be defined as the man who never wasted a second.
I had a telephone call from Robert about 18 months to 2 years ago. And he asked me if I would play at his memorial service. Well, of course, I burst out laughing. I said, my dear Robert, I'll be dead long before you. And nobody said, I'd like you to play Fikiri Tikanawa and Geraint Evans. And I'd like you to make up two songs for Kiri to sing and two songs of Schubert and two songs for Geraint to sing. Well, I said, Robert, I will send you the program with great pleasure, but I'm quite sure I shan't be here to play it.
I have actually heard the hint that he wants me to sing at his memorial concert, which is absolutely charming, and I hope it's not for a very long time yet. But I would very much like, if I had a choice of my own, I would like to sing the music of my era and of my time and of the music that I sang during my lifetime, because I'm sure somewhere along the line, 100 years ago, there was some lovely music at the beginning of his life. And at the time of my life, I would like to be able to sing something like, I suppose, Walton Britton, or even Songs of the Auvergne, which has got some of the most beautiful haunting things. I wouldn't like it to sound sort of too funereal, but something that would make me feel good. I must say, memorials to me rather depress me, so I hope it doesn't go for a long time yet.
My theory is we're given a spark by something, by some force, and that spark, that force then says, all right, we've done our bit, we've given you the spark, now you go on. So you go on your own. We're born in order to struggle, in order to struggle. So the opposite of struggle is you must be imperfect, otherwise you needn't struggle. And if we were perfect, if we were not meant to struggle, we wouldn't have a damn thing to do. We'd twiddle our thumbs. Nothing would happen in the world. No tree would be in the springtime, no woman would bear a child, nothing would happen. So we're meant to struggle before we're born until we pass on to somewhere which nobody, we're not meant to know where to go.